Very good day, happy Saturday, and a happy welcome to the summer. Bangalore summer has started off, and this year it promises to be a little more harsh compared to other years because we've had very little rain and people are complaining bitterly about shortage of water. Anyway, this is the price that we pay for, you know, taking advantage of nature, neglecting ecology and all these things. But today's topic, as you know by now, is to do more with human beings and the way they treat us and the way we treat them. So I have used this word dealing with betrayal. Now, betrayal, of course, is a very strong word. I purposely used it. The idea being to help us to understand what happens if somebody has betrayed us, or somebody has been unfaithful to us, or somebody has been disloyal to us, or somebody has done some treachery, you know, behind your back. They have gone and done something and you were not aware and you trusted that person. So that is the fundamental thing that I want you to start with. That if you talk about somebody who has betrayed you, who has been treacherous, who has been, you know, stabbing you behind the back, as they say, all these things, anything like that, if that happens in life, let us first understand that it starts with the fact that we trust that person. You see, a stranger cannot betray you because you will not trust that person. If you're walking on the road with a huge amount of money, you're not going to ask a passing by stranger, can you hold this bag? It is very heavy because it contains so many lakhs of rupees. Can you carry this for me? We are obviously not going to do that. But when we trust somebody, you know, we feel that that person has earned our trust and we can be nice to that person. And that is when the person lets us down. It could be in many, many forms. It could be, let's say, you know, in money or financial matters. It could be in, you know, somebody cheating you in some way, somebody letting you down, somebody promising something and then backing out of the thing. Somebody taking advantage of your niceness and then giving it back in a very negative manner. All these things, many, many, many of us have been through this in bigger or smaller ways. But the bottom line is that the more you trust the person, the greater is the hurt of the so-called betrayal. If I do not trust that person, then there's very little chance, as I said, of that person betraying you, isn't it? So we have to use this trust as a foundation or as a fundamental principle to understand. If I am trying to analyze, why was I let down by this person? Why was I betrayed by this person? I need to work on that. Generally, these type of, you know, letting downs or being cheated or being put down by somebody starts in adolescence, because adolescence is the peer age. That's a time when we connect very closely to our peers, that is our friends, our classmates, our neighbors, those type of people who belong to our age group. Because during adolescence, we don't trust adults. Somehow we think that, you know, adults don't understand us. Adults only keep lecturing to us. Adults only tell us what to do, but they never, you know, take our opinion into something. So because of that, what do? I start leaning more and more and more on my peers. And most of us, I'm sure, sometime or the other have been let down by somebody who was close to us. This person was my friend. This person was my bestie. This person I trusted a lot, and this person cheated me or put me down or did something horrible to me. And that is what, you know, we start off with. In adult life, this sort of betrayal can become even more serious. Maybe there are big money matters. Maybe it's a very serious relationships. People have been let down by their own spouse. They trust their spouse. They enter into wedlock thinking that it's a lifelong thing, that this is my life partner. We give everything of ours, and one fine day we wake up to find that that person has, you know, really done something horrible to us, which is beyond tolerance. And we are shocked. We don't understand why this could have happened. when I was so nice to this person. So that is what we are going to be, you know, dealing with today to understand why these things happen. The first is to understand, was my expectation too high? This is whether it's a teenage friend, whether it's a spouse, whether it's a business partner or whoever it may be. Were my expectations from this person too high? Did I want so much from this person, which this person could not have given me, and therefore the person put me down or cheated me or whatever it is? So whenever you feel that you have been betrayed, or even the fact that you are likely to be betrayed, you are getting suspicious that something is not going very well in this relationship. The first thing that I want you to ask yourself is that, did I have very high expectations from this person? If so, then we have to pay the price for it. I'll give you a very sad example that happened. One of my classmates used to live in a locality where there were a lot of poor people in the surroundings. And one of his friends happened to be from a village who had come to the city and was doing odd jobs. You know, he had dropped out of school and he used to wash cars or clean up things and earn his money that way. So anyway, peer age. So he became part of my friend's group, and therefore he became part of my group, and we struck up a good friendship. To me, it made no difference whether financially, you know, he's in a different situation. Anyway, he grew up and he became a lorry driver. And then when I was living in Bombay, he used to come from our hometown, you know, driving the lorry. And he used to come and stay with me in the hostel overnight. Whenever he had to stay overnight in Bombay, he used to come and stay with me. Obviously, lodges and all that were too expensive, so he used to save that money. He used to come and stay with me, have food in the hostel, and go away the next day or whatever, whenever he had to drive back. That continued for some time. In fact, he taught me how to drive a lorry. That was something very, very fascinating. I learned how, you know, a huge lorry can be driven. I was so fascinated and so happy when I drove his lorry. Anyway, that phase passed off. We dispersed. We hardly met at any time, anywhere. I moved off to Bangalore. I lost touch with him. One fine day, he called me up and he said that, "I've got your, you know, number from some common person. How are you doing? It's been so many years," and this and that. I said, "Good to have caught up with you. How are you doing? What's happening?" He said, "Now I'm too old to drive a lorry. So what I've done is that I've taken up an agency for some spices. I go and sell these spices wholesale to shops, and they in turn sell it in retail. So that's how I'm making my money." I said, "Fine, good, whatever it is you're doing, I'm happy for you." Then he said that, "I want to, you know, see if there's a market in Bangalore. I'm coming there." I said, "Most welcome, come. If you want, you can stay with me," or whatever it is. Anyway, he turned up and he had brought those spices and he tried to sell them to some shopkeepers. He wasn't getting much of a demand. So what I did was, whatever that huge bag of full of spices that he had brought, I said, "Now you'll have to lug them all the way. I will buy them off. And either I will sell or even give it free to my friends and acquaintances. It doesn't matter." I did that. And he was very thankful and he went away. Then he came back again after some time and he said, "I got one order from somebody in Bangalore whom I had met last time. So I brought that you know, stock of spices and I gave it to him and I made some money and I'm happy, etc." Again, he had a meal with me and evening train he caught and he went away. In the third or fourth visit, he came to me and he said, "When I go around locally, you know, I'm no longer able to ride a bicycle. So I have to carry these spices in an auto rickshaw and that becomes very expensive. If I could buy a small secondhand moped and fix a carrier to that, I can move around very freely with very minimal expenditure and I can cover a lot of ground and I can sell these spices. A secondhand moped costs 25,000 rupees. I don't have that type of money. I have to pay for my daughter's college education, etc., etc. If I were to get that money, I can easily pay back minimum 5,000 rupees a month and in 5 months I can finish it off." I said, "I know this guy right from childhood. And if he can get such a big you know, boost to his earnings and business, what's so great about it?" I gave him that 25,000. Can you believe that was the last I saw of him? His phone was switched off. I asked one or two common friends also. They said, no, we don't know where he is. He's not in touch. Now, I don't know whether I should call it betrayal, because did I have very high expectations? Did I trust him too much? Knowing that he belongs to that financial background where 25,000 was a huge amount for him. As soon as he went back, maybe he had some loans. Maybe those loan sharks were threatening to beat him up or something. So he pulled out whatever money he owed them and he gave it off. Maybe his wife was not well and he was not able to get her treatment. So he said, now that I have money, let me pay for the treatment and get. And before he knew it, the bulk of that 25,000 was gone and there was no more paid. And he could not get in touch with me because he had no face to, come back to me. I kept thinking, even if he had called up and said that this is what has happened, I went through a financial crisis. So I did not buy that, moped. I'll work on something and see how I can return that money or whatever I can do for you. I would have said, okay, and I would have written it off. But he didn't do that. So it hurt me. Obviously, it hurt me. But if I introspect, my expectation was high. And I trusted him too much. Next time something like this threatens to happen to you, check yourself whether there were any warning signs. In retrospect, yes, there were warning signs. He was saying that, I have taken some loans. He said that my wife is not keeping good health. All that he had told me. So there were warning signs that the moment money comes in his hand, he's going to use it for something else. The other thing to note is that how does he deal with others? I didn't take the trouble of finding out. Later, I came to know that he has done this with 3-4 people, common friends. So the moment I have a doubt, there was no urgency that I had to pay him. I could have just called up 2-3 friends who are in touch with him and checked with them. And if I had come to know that he has been taking money and not repaying them, my answer would have been simple, that I'm not going to give you. I'd rather give you 5,000 rupees as a donation, take it and go, rather than giving you 25,000 loan and expecting you to give it back to me. Now, when that happens, please also remember that the more you love, care, or value that person, the greater are the chances of betrayal. That's why I said that one of the worst is when your own life partner betrays you. So many people, suddenly get a shock of their life when they realize that a partner has been doing things behind your back and, you are absolutely devastated. Same thing can happen if you have a sibling or you have an absolute best friend or your own parent or your child or somebody lets you down. Now here, comes this question. If you have been betrayed, would you like to build back that relationship or would you like to give up on that? Are you in any way dependent on that person? Do you have to maintain a relationship with the person? So everything depends on that. Sometimes we are forced to maintain a relationship with somebody. If you have someone who's very close to you and you cannot physically get away from that person and that person betrays you, it's not that easy to get away. You still have to maintain some sort of a, relationship. Anyway, the point is that once you evaluate that and you see what is happening, the best thing to do is to first, resist being impulsive, resist being aggressive or getting into a conflict or anything like that. It never pays. That's been my experience. I feel I have been betrayed. This is the time for me to calm down, sit, think what is the impact and what is happening. Otherwise, I'll become suspicious of everybody and I will stop trusting anyone, which is a very bad sign, isn't it? So I need to introspect and think that what are the possible outcomes of this betrayal? This betrayal has happened. This person has cheated me. This person has let me down. This person has done something horrible to me. Let me evaluate like a checklist. What are the possible outcomes? So Anis has made a nice little slide to help us to think what are the possible outcomes that may happen to me if I have gone through this betrayal. So I need to put a tick mark to those which are applicable. One is, as I said, emotions go haywire. I may get very angry. I may be in a rage. I may be wanting to take revenge. I may be talking horrible things against that person. So if I realize my emotions are going haywire, I need to work on it myself. There's a constant focus only on that person. Doesn't that happen? We forget so many other people who have been nice to us, who have been good to us, who are continuing to be good to us, but we neglect them because our focus is only on that horrible person who has let me down so badly. That brings us to this question, you know, very often it happens. Why me? Why should I suffer? Why was I cheated? Did I do something wrong to somebody? I didn't. So did I deserve to be cheated like this? I didn't. Then why me? Why has it happened to me? Then it can lead to anxiety, depression, low self-esteem, a sense of shame. People must be laughing at me that, you know, I trusted this person. It could even have sleep disturbances and nightmares and things like that. Please be aware of that. There could be a physical pain. You know how closely the mind and body are connected to each other. When the mind is very, very disturbed, it causes a lot of physical pain. It can even in extreme cases lead to panic attacks, anxiety. What will happen to me in future? Will everybody betray me? Will I have no life left? Will I have nothing to look forward to in future? Once that starts, then you start getting panic attacks. Some people in those extreme cases even start getting thoughts of suicide. Life is just not worth it. What's the point in living like this? It is all over. We don't see anything beyond in the future. Hope is gone. We find it difficult to trust in others. This is a very important thing. We inevitably have so many other people who are nice to us, but we stop trusting them because somebody else has let down my trust. We tend to generalize it. No. Attachment issues? Yes. We have issues in attachment to others. When normally we would have been very close to them, but we start drifting away from, people. You can even have, you know, like I said, how the mind controls the body. You can have eating disorders, stomach upset. The gastrointestinal system is very, very susceptible to what is happening in the mind. So the moment you find that there is a possibility that you are having some digestive problems or eating disorders or anything like that, please remember that it is connected to your mind more often than not. And in some cases, at least, it leads to substance abuse, getting into cigarettes, alcohol, drugs, anything like that. So these are the possible outcomes. I'm not saying everybody who is betrayed goes through this, but these are the possible outcomes that can happen to you. Why I listed this down is to help you to understand that it is important for me to work on overcoming that betrayal or that cheating that has happened to me. Time is not the best healer if the betrayal has been very, very big. In the incident that I gave you, I can, you know, afford to lose 25,000 rupees. So I said, okay, I write it off, maybe in honor of the friendship of 30 years or whatever it is, and have pity on the guy that, you know, he's been leading such a miserable life compared to me who has been so well off. So I could write it off and it didn't bother. But like I said, if it had been somebody very close to me, if my brother had done this to me, if my best friend had done it to me, if my spouse had done it to me, it's not that easy to overcome that. So let us understand that we have to work towards healing. We have to actively make sure that we don't continue to suffer. Like I had mentioned earlier, you know, our focus only goes on that betrayal. Why did that happen to me? How dare he do that? What was wrong? Why did I trust him? All these factors come in, no? So let us see now, we have listed down, you know, how to deal with the betrayal. Once it has happened and you know that you are gone through it, what is it that, you know, we need to do in order to overcome that? Not this, next. How to heal from the betrayal. Okay. What are the steps that I can possibly take? First thing I would suggest is assess the physical, financial, and emotional damage. These are three completely distinct things. I mentioned to you there could be a physical damage. I may be getting migraines, I may be having sleepless nights, I may be having gastrointestinal problems. Similarly, financial, how bad was the financial, you know, hurt? Has it cut me down? Have I run into debt? Have I lost out on money which I was going to use for something which was very important to me? And similarly, the emotional damage, how angry I am, how upset I am, how, you know, strong are my feelings. Then before we proceed, acknowledge your own role, whether I neglected, there were signs which I did not give heed to. I could have checked this person before trusting the person completely. Was I blind in trusting this person? Once you acknowledge your own role, you're in a much better position to deal with similar situations in future and also to overcome the hurt that this act of this person has caused you. Then we need to accept that it has happened and that I have been cheated. This thing of why me, why me, why me can go on indefinitely. When we say why me, we are actually not asking a question. It's a rhetorical thing, why me, meaning to say I should not have suffered. It should not have happened to me. So best is to accept that it has happened and I have been cheated or I have been let down. Then do a simple exercise, list out the emotions you went through. Anger, rage, frustration, shame, whatever may be the emotions, even guilt that I should not have used this or I should not have done that. Whatever the emotion, please list them down. It's very, very useful because all our, you know, actions are based on our emotions. And the two most debilitating emotions, anger and guilt. If I am having any form of anger or if I am feeling guilty that I should not have trusted, I should not have allowed this person to cheat me, either of those, if they are lingering, please deal with them first before you go ahead to anything else. I need not tell you, avoid impulsive revenge or reaction. Never ever take any steps when you are in that, you know, emotional state. Calm down, get away from that place, take a break, sleep over it, go for a pilgrimage, say prayers, whatever you believe in, whatever you want to do, do, but do not take any impulsive steps. Give space from that person. If that person is close to you and if you're interacting on a daily basis, what happens is every time there is a prick on the same place where you have been hurt. So give space, get away from that person as far as possible, at least for the time being, so that you don't have to see his face, you don't have to interact with him and keep getting more and more agitated because of what that person has done to you. Then get reflection from any trusted person or persons. There are a few selected people around. If you have built up one or two or three such people also, it's very, very useful. Just sit down with that person and say, this happened. What is your response to it? What do you think I should do now? What do you think, how do you think I should tackle this or deal with this? Get that reflection from at least one trusted person, if possible, more than one. Practice self-care and forgiveness. I have to forgive myself, otherwise I'll continue to feel guilty. I will take care of myself. Just because somebody else has been bad to me doesn't mean that I have to neglect myself. And as I mentioned, counseling, one of the most important ways is to reach out to somebody who is neutral, who is empathic, who cares for you and who has the time. Just that catharsis of talking over with a counselor can go a long way. Then be patient with your own self. There are times when I've seen that, no, I should not allow this to happen. How can this happen? I can't keep quiet. I can't do this. Be patient with yourself. Tell yourself that, yes, it has happened. No, I have time. I can think over it. There's no deadline. There's no hurry that I have to do something. So let me be patient even with my own self. Okay. So these are some of the things which we need to work on. There are so many more. See, in human behavior, as I always tell you, there is no hard and fast rule that you have to do this or you have to do that. So what I do is I list out possible options to you, which is what I have given in this slide. Now you can change, you can modify, you can make it suitable to your situation and the circumstances which you have gone through. Based on that, you can decide, how you would like to deal with it and how would you like to cope and resolve it. Just allowing time to take care of it does not work. Doing something impulsively, reacting in a negative manner can even make matters worse. So in between, you have to systematically work out how I am going to deal with this, betrayal. That can be done by each one of us. If we have that serenity, that patience, that ability to think in a calm manner, what we need to understand is one betrayal, one cheating or letdown, however bad it is not the end of the world. We live in an ocean of people. We have innumerable relationships. We go through so many ups and downs. In this situation, we should not allow ourselves to think that everything has gone bad. I told you, some people stop trusting anybody and everybody because one person has let down the trust. Remember, there is nobody who is as important to control your life. I even mentioned, even if it's your own life partner who has betrayed you, doesn't matter. Life still remains, even if the partner does not remain. You can move on. You can do something. Your own child may betray you. Your own very, very loved one can betray you. Nothing happens. You can still work on these things. Also remember, equally important, that by this betrayal, there is a blessing in disguise. What is that? You have become stronger. Provided you use it to your advantage. If you tell yourself, while financially or physically or whatever it is, I have suffered a loss, but I have gained in terms of becoming emotionally and mentally stronger. I know that tomorrow I can deal with very, very tough and difficult situations because of this horrible experience that I went through. The more you can convince yourself on that, the more you start believing on that, the more positive outlook you will have towards the rest of your life. In fact, I even suggest, if it is possible, thank that person who let you down. In your mind, not going and thanking him, obviously. In your own mind, just thank that person. Because you cheated me, now I have become wiser. I have become more capable. I know what my expectations with others should be. I know how to deal with people, whom to trust, and to what extent to trust. Remember that some people are trustworthy in some areas and not trustworthy in certain areas. Somebody may be bad in financial matters, but he will always be there to support you in case you need some emergency. You can trust him to come and rush to take care of you. So that way, segregate, decide whom you can trust, to what extent, start on a fresh note and see how life can be as good and even better than what it was before this unfortunate incident hit you. So with that, I come to the end of my first half hour. And Meera is here to give you a quick update. There are a lot of interesting things happening in Banjara. She will give you that update and then I will be back.
Good afternoon, everyone. So I was sitting here and with you all, even I was listening to Ali. And I caught on to one point of his where he said that, counseling, where you can go and talk to a trusted third person And, you know, you can share your thoughts without being judged or in confidentiality. So like that only we, in fact, we've been also hearing a lot of things where, you know, people say that now because mental health is given a lot of importance, thank God to that, and people are taking it seriously, but it's also become expensive. So we at Banjara here believe that, you know, everybody should be able to get that help. Everybody should be heard. Everybody should have that confidentiality and not be judged. So we at Banjara, we give free counseling through email, phone. You can drop by here. You can, you know, talk to us. You can, you know, reach out to us in any medium and we'll be there for you. But we also feel that, you know, if you feel you have that in you where you're approachable, empathetic, and people are coming towards you and you feel that you can help people, then we also have the course. And our this year's course successfully is coming to an end and we are starting the new batch very, very soon. So if you feel that you can, you know, join and you want to be a part of this counseling community and help people with their mental health, do feel free to get in touch with us. We are also celebrating a special cash scholarship only till next Saturday, that is 16th March, for Women's Day. So for more details, you can get in touch with our office and with our coordinators and you will get all the details. We are also having our Youngs and Blossoms. That's our much awaited summer camp for children. In fact, the inquiries start much before. And this is, you know, 10-day, two camps we are conducting from 25th March to 5th April. The first one is from 10:30 to 12:30. And this is a hands-on understanding of life skills for children. And the methodologies, like you can see, are role plays, activities, storytelling, discussions, and much, much more. We don't have talking and gyan and all, but we have a super fun time at the same time without losing the essence of life skills and imbibing them in children, because it's so important for children. And last but not the least, we are having our special education educator seminar on April 6th. And there also, it's going to be amazing. So you have the poster on the screen and you can see. And if feel anyone can benefit it or you can benefit from it, please do join us and also call the office for further details. Having said that, now I'd go back to Dr. Ali and we take the session forward.
Yes, I'm back to the more interesting part of this program. That is all the collective wisdom from all of you. Let us see what your comments and your questions are. Vinita says, hi, Dr. Lee. But sometimes, isn't it very hurtful to move on when someone whom you trusted so much betrayed you? Yes, I do get what you just said. But it's really hard when it comes to a person who is really close or special to you. Agreed, Vinita. If it was easy, then we wouldn't be having this discussion at all. I told you, no? If the auto rickshaw driver cheats you of 20 rupees or the shopkeeper cheats you of 50 rupees, it's very easy to forget it and move on and say that, you know, that's it. I write off stupid fellow. I'll never trust him again. But when it is somebody close to you, that is when it hurts. I know it is difficult, but what I want to emphasize is it's not impossible. It is possible. It's difficult. It takes a lot of effort. It can hurt. It can cause so many things. But still, eventually, if you go through it, you'll be cutting down your consequent, you know, upheavals of life and the trauma that you keep going through. So you heal yourself by that, however long it takes, whatever effort it takes. Vinita, no, Vinita's we have already answered. We'll go on to the next one. Florence says, treachery causes deep hurts. Good afternoon, sir. Yes, Florence, it causes very deep hurts. And as I always tell, no, deep hurts, time is not the best healer. Superficial hurts, as it happens in physical hurts, if I just by mistake cut myself with a knife, there's a blob of blood. All I need to do is wash it, at the most put some band-aid or something, And before you know it, it starts healing. But when it is a deep hurt, we have to actually do something systematically. And that's the reason why I gave this list of possible ways by which you can deal with that deeper hurt. Take as many of them as possible and work on that. Then you will find that it will work. Okay. Roshan says, believing and trusting your own self have created positive vibes inside me. With the result, I have attracted similar people with whom I can trust and be friendly with. Yes, this is a very important thing, you know. When you give out those vibes, then you attract that type of people. There are chances that some people whom I trust have let me down, but that has made me stronger emotionally and I can deal with any challenges or difficult situations. Exactly. That is what I ended my first half hour with, that any betrayal, any cheating, any letdown makes us stronger if we are willing to learn that lesson. That is very important. And yes, we have Surekha. After an act of betrayal, can living transparently help to build trust? This means that there are no secrets and you are willing to answer any questions that you need to answer. Transparency always helps, Surekha. The moment I lead a life which, as they say, you know, is an open book, if people know that I'm not a hypocrite, I'm not saying one thing to one person, another thing to another person, I'm not hiding things from people and being very mysterious. If I do that, then I know that I am on the right track. And I know that I can deal a better quality of life and have better relationships. Surekha also says, when the person is non-defensive, it is as if he is saying, I'm sorry for what I have done. I know that I have hurt you and I'm willing to do whatever it takes. I am sorry. Wonderful. Yes, it does happen. Sometimes the person hurts us very badly. Maybe on an impulse, he did it purposely. Maybe it just happened that what he did hurt you badly. But either way, if that person is saying, sorry for what I have done, I know that I have hurt you and I'm willing to do whatever it takes, I'm sorry. I think it's a wonderful situation. We must, you know, go as far as possible to forgive that person and allow that person to make amends, at the same time being careful not to trust the person too much. That is where you need to draw the line. That is very, very, you know, important. Right. Vinita says, I agree. We do become stronger, but sometimes we also tend not to trust anyone easily. We should become careful thereafter. See, there's a difference between being careful and not trusting anybody. This is what I want you to understand. There are people, I mentioned this earlier also, whom you can trust in certain areas and to a certain extent. If I give 1 rupee to a person, I can trust him. But if I give 10 rupees, no, I can't trust him. He may run away with it. That is what we need to understand. In money matters, I can't trust him. But in other matters, maybe I can trust him. That is a wonderful life skill which all of us need to learn. Sharayu says, hi Ali, sometimes we are close to family, all are good, but the responsible one person has habit of betrayal. Rest of members are nice, how to continue relationship? See, you're very lucky when you find that the rest of the people are very nice. Only one person is being bad to you. So balance it out. It is like if I invest my money in 10 different you know, investments, 9 of them pay me back very good dividend, 1 lets me down. Will I be at a disadvantage? Not at all. I can write off that loss because I know that. So focus on the other 9 people who are good to you. Build your strengths through that. Try to minimize your impact with that one responsible or irresponsible person, I would say, and focus more on these people who are nice to you. Yes, Surekha has raised a very relevant question. How do we deal with a person who has betrayed trust repeatedly? See, if I get cheated once, it's a coincidence. if I have been cheated the second time, then there is something not okay. If I have been cheated repeatedly, then I need to look inward. It is not that person's fault. That person realizes that despite cheating you, despite betraying you, you still keep your doors open to him. And if he's a selfish person, why would he not like to take advantage? So if anyone has been betrayed repeatedly, please understand, however cruel it sounds, that it is my fault. Again, coming back to marriage, I know of people who have been betrayed repeatedly by their spouse, and yet they keep trusting, yet they keep going back. Then they cannot blame the other person. You handed it over to the person and allowed that person to, betray you, cheat you, hurt you, etc. Sajima says, it is easier to let go if you are hurt. But when you see a child being betrayed and see them suffer afterwards, it's heart-wrenching. Very true. We all love our children, regardless of their age. We want to protect them. We want to make sure it's good. But if you find that your child is being hurt or cheated, I think my responsibility as a parent would be to impart life skills to my child. Today, one person has betrayed him. Tomorrow, second, third, fourth will happen. As he grows up and becomes independent and runs his own life, he is likely to face many, many such situations. So the moment I realize that my child has been betrayed or hurt by somebody, I need to overcome that heart-wrenching feeling that I have got, take the responsibility and say, now I'm going to teach my child more of life skills. And the greater the life skills of that person, decision-making, problem-solving, management of emotions, dealing with stress, the more I can teach those skills to my child, the better he will be able to deal with any type of situation. Right. Madhavi says, I had a bad experience, but my presence of mind helped me. My maid wanted to cheat by, I want immediate money, 10,000 rupees for my niece's delivery expenses. She's in Mandya hospital. Husband was about to give money. Then I stopped him in Mandya. You many friends. So please tell somebody to go and help personally. Yes, that was a wonderful thing. If it is true. But I was taken aback that there was no such case there. And then the next day, many neighborhood compelled, and I've lost this much and that much. And I said, sorry, because of you did not know anything about it. But I moved on today. See, a simple precaution like this. I mentioned that in the case where I lost out at that 25. All I had to do was to call up a couple of common friends and check what's happening with this fellow, because he lives in a different city. And I would have got the answer. But I got it too late. Afterwards, when I mentioned it to people, they said, "What? Why did you trust that guy? He goes around doing these things nowadays." So that is what I'm saying, that it is possible. This is a wonderful example of what Madhavi told us, that how she protected herself by taking this simple precaution, told her husband, you know people in Mandya, let them go and check in the hospital, find out whether there's really a need or not. Sandhya says, good afternoon, Ali. If the betrayal is with our people and further harming our image with all other relatives and doesn't feel sorry for what he is doing and continue the same with help of elders, it hurts a lot when elders also support. Yes, Sandhya, that's a very, very sad situation to be in. Sometimes these people, take advantage of the old age or the innocence or whatever it is of the elders, give them a sob story, tell them how they are suffering and this and that, and they get them on their side. It happens. A lot of scheming people who do that. But like I said, it is my responsibility now to protect myself when this person is going on further harming my image, telling other relatives and all that. I should at least select one or two important relatives and make them sit down and explain to them what the reality is. I need not go and keep talking to every relative or every person. But if I can talk it over with one or two very trusted people and tell them that, can you please convey on my behalf to others? There are ways and means like this to get over it. Surekha says, dealing with betrayal is all about trusting yourself and not the other person. It's like saying, if he betrays me again, I'll be fine. Because I believe in me and I'm betting on me, not on him. Very well put, Surekha. Wonderful. So many times Rekha comes up with very unusual things, which I always admire. That is what it is. It is a question of trusting yourself. What am I doing? What is my life? Which is the way I am dealing with difficult situations and difficult relationships? Shahayu says, why is it some people are more vulnerable than others? It could be because of innocence. It could be because of their upbringing, where they were told to trust everybody and, you know, to listen. They were led a very protected life. They were never seen what is the outcome of, you know, being betrayed. It could also be due to low self-esteem or a feeling of loneliness. If I don't oblige people, then they will go away from me and I will be left alone. So therefore, let me oblige them, and thereby I get cheated more and more. That's how we become vulnerable. Surekha says, how can you deal with the spouse who's refusing to accept that she has betrayed her husband despite enough evidence to the contrary? She keeps on dragging past matters and sidesteps her act of betrayal of having an affair with another man. Now here, everything depends on her spouse. It is he who is going to decide whether he is going to tolerate that betrayal or not, and how he is. As a concerned adult or as a counselor, I can only empower him, the victim spouse, to understand what is going on, to make him aware of the realities, and to encourage him and empower him to take whatever decision he wants. I know of cases where there are spouses who say, it doesn't matter. My spouse has had an affair, so what? I still love my spouse. It's their lookout. We don't interfere in their lives, isn't it? Roshan says, one wants to be happy, learn to let go and accept whatever comes your way. Never keep a grudge in your heart, as this causes ill health. Very true. That's what I mentioned. No, the heart, mind and body are so closely connected. Always send loving energies to the person who has hurt you, and that is his reflection, not yours. Be at peace and always joyful. Yes, that should be an ideal situation. Not all of us can achieve that, but we should be working towards that. That's good enough if we are doing this thing. Sajima also said, thank you, Ali, for the wonderful session. Thank all of you for contributing so much to these sessions and making them so much more meaningful and lively. This is the part which I really enjoy, and I inevitably every Saturday I take back a few points and quickly go and jot them down so that it increases my knowledge and my ability to deal with different situations, which I can share with so many others once I get it from you. So with a wonderful thank you to all of you, let me wind up today's session. And Anis has already put on the slide of next week, Saturday, 16th March, improving communication skills. So see you next Saturday. Bye-bye.